Okay, so this is my last class. So I give you my email address. I'm here up to 14th lunch. So in case if you have any question, we can discuss anytime. This is my mobile number. I write in capital. This is DUTTA@iitk.ac.in. So for any question, you can contact me. I will be try to provide at least the relevant reference. I leave it here for some time. So since people must be sleepy now, I decided to start with some problems. Okay. So first, there was a beautiful question from one of my colleagues sitting here, that you are talking about Ising model with nearest neighbor interaction. What is so special about nearest neighbor interaction? Why don't you take an Ising model, transverse Ising model, which has, let's say, interactions like sigma I plus 1, then make it more complicated, I plus 2, and so on. And then you give your field. How does the results you had deriving here, Kivel-Zurek result, how does it get altered when you introduce further near interactions? Question here is what we are interested in. Okay? I told you in the very first class that there is a notion of universality. What do you mean by universality? Your critical exponents, which are playing a role or which are showing up in the discussion of Kivel-Zurek scaling, these critical exponents do not really depend upon the range of interaction. It is not a watertight statement. I will tell you clearly later. It depends upon the symmetry of the order parameter. That means whether it is Ising model, up-down symmetry, or it is XY model, U1 symmetry, or say Heisenberg model. Okay? So, as long as you lambda is equal to 0, where lambda is h minus 1 in the present model, this h will get changed. So, critical value hc will no longer be equal to 1. So, if you give further neighbor interaction, your critical point will change. I never said that critical point is universal, but the exponents will not. But there is a catch here. You can add 1000 interactions here. Critical exponent should not change. This is the concept of universality. But someone may say, well, I will give a long range interaction which is very non-trivial. Okay? I will give you, first let me talk about classical without the transverse field. Alpha. Yes, alpha could be something, and depending upon what alpha is, critical exponents change. But that is different issue. I am not going into that. All the difference here, it's a finite never. This is an infinite neighbor. All of them are interacting with each other. But if alpha is very large, let someone say alpha is 1000, okay? Then you will see this is effectively a short range interaction, okay? And then your critical behavior will be like that of a short range Ising model, okay? Why this happens? Because I told many times that xi is the length scale of the problem near a critical point, xi, that is the correlation length. How two spins are summed at some distance are correlated. Okay? If xi is the correlation length, you know the xi is actually divergingly large close to a critical point, right? So, if you say your range of interaction is 1000, near the critical point, 1000 has to be scaled with the length scale of your problem. Okay? So, 1000 by xi close to the critical point is 0. So, essentially it is a short range problem. What is the difference here? Why do you expect a difference here? Because here there is no length scale in the problem. There is no interaction is infinite range, though it decays in the further neighbors. Okay? So, there is no length scale which should be compared with xi. Right? And then here critical behavior gets altered. Critical behavior gets altered. But there should be, as I said, if alpha is very, very large, it's short range. Yes. They do. Actually, if you take 1D Ising model, classical, this is no transverse field. I should use a different color chalk probably here. Classical here. Here also same argument holds for classical and quantum. So, 1D Ising, if you have 1 by Rij to the power 1 plus sigma, there will be an interesting behavior. One can show that sigma less than 1, sigma less than 1, you have a 1D Ising model, we all know, Tc is 0. 1D Ising model, if it is a nearest neighbor interaction or finite neighbor interaction, Tc is 0. It gets disordered as soon as you put in some thermal fluctuations in the problem. Now, what happens if you have this type of interaction in 1D Ising model? So, effectively, you can write a Pyrrhus argument. Those who have done this Ising model and Pyrrhus argument, you can calculate through Pyrrhus argument that sigma less than 1. Sigma increases means interaction falls off very, very fast. It goes towards a short range model. Okay? So, if sigma is less than 1, there is a finite Tc which is a function of sigma, even in 1D Ising model. So, effectively, giving an infinite range interaction, you have augmented the dimensionality of the system. Okay? And there is far more interesting thing. There is a mean field region from half sigma to 1, referring to question whether it is continuously varying. There is a mean field region. Here you have mean field exponents. In this region, you have continuously varying exponent. And there is one more beautiful situation happens when sigma is equal to 1. Sigma is equal to 1, what is the interaction? Interaction is 1 by r square interaction, okay? Inverse square interaction. And there, one finds a transition. This transition is a Kosterlis-Thouless transition. Kosterlis-Thouless transition. So, this is all I wanted to say. This is a beautiful problem started by, if I remember correctly, in 1971, Anderson and Ewell in the context of Kondo model. And even today, people are studying this. Now, I put a quantum thing here, this quantum thing. It will be fascinatingly interesting, I am sure, to see, and quenching nobody has studied. Okay? So, this is all. I hope I answered the question you asked, right? Okay. Okay. Now, second question. Second thing, I have been considering about thermodynamically large systems. I have been talking about the systems which are very large and ideally thermodynamically large, L goes to infinity. And I told you in the very beginning that all the singularities we see are thermodynamic in the thermodynamic limit. Now, someone may ask you the question that I give you a finite chain of size L. So, I will just give these problems, indicate the solutions, and rest is student's responsibility. Finite chain. Okay? I prepare it in ground state. I drive it. There is a quote unquote quantum critical point. You have to tell me why I say it quote unquote. And then I tell me what tau I should change my field with so that I do not generate any defect. Question is clear or should I repeat it? Repeat. I have been talking about transverse Ising chain, thermodynamic chain, okay, infinitely large, okay, and everything. I said this Kvesle-Dirac scaling, which you remember was tau to the power minus nu d nu z plus 1. Now, I ask the question, okay, I do not have a sufficiently long chain, but not thermodynamically large. I want to drive it, change the magnetic field and take it to the so-called quantum critical point. You know why I am saying so-called. And then I am asking the question that give me the tau. I should be slow. How slow should I be? What should be my tau? How do you calculate that? Any hints from the student? Yes, you take periodic boundary condition. Spectrum will always be gapped as long as your L is finite. And that's why I am calling it a so-called quantum critical point. Because gap will vanish only in the L going to infinity limit. So, I give you the indication how to do it. See, this we have derived, right? Tau to the power nu by nu z plus 1. Okay? This we derived. And I told you, if you do it for nonlinear quenching, then you, at least some of you may have seen that using the same argument, this goes like r nu z plus 1. This is a rescaling of the parameter exponent nu. Okay? Now, this we have found out, right? Now, I have a finite chain. I do not want any defect. How should be, what limits my xi hat? What? Questions are not for you. It is the system size. So, now you have got the answer. This is it. Okay? Now, you build on it. Second problem. Now, I change this from minus t to plus t using that quenching rate. Okay? Theek hai? So, you can find out what is the defect density once you know this. You know what is the defect density once you know this I hat, right? Now, second question I am giving you, optimize r, optimized value of r. Okay? How do you do that? Okay, I will not tell you how do you do that. It is very easy, maximum minima problem, and you will find out very interesting result of R. And if you are stuck here, this is a fantastic paper. This nonlinear thing was first done by Deepthiman and Krishnendu and Shoshi, and later it is generalized by for this optimization. I do not know the precise reference that will be in my, but this is sufficient to tell you where this is done. Yeah. Okay. So, I have a third problem. No, that is probably second. I give you two many body systems which are reducible to once again 2 by 2 problems, okay? Decoupled 2 by 2 problems in the Fourier space. I am giving you two situations. One is this reduced 2 by 2 problem is mu t I b f mod q y. Qx square, oh, I am writing k here, so I should be careful. Kx square by 2m minus I vf mod ky plus kx square over 2m minus mu t where mu is equal to t by tau. Second problem is HK mu t IVF, or I can simply say VF KX minus IKY VF
KX.
I should write KY, KX. Y I Q X minus mu t. Again, both the cases mu goes as T by tau. So, you have a this is k also. I have mixed up k and q anywhere? No. So there is no q. Okay, this is k. I should be very careful. So these are just momentums. And now these are momenta kx and ky. It immediately tells you have a two-dimensional problem. Whatever I have done is one-dimensional problem. And many of you have seen the second Hamiltonian. You know what is this Hamiltonian? Anybody? It is the graphene Hamiltonian. You are looking at single Dirac point, and this is the graphene Hamiltonian. Okay? And what is this Hamiltonian? This is a funny thing. This is linear, okay? And this is quadratic. This is called a semi-Dirac Hamiltonian. So this is precisely the Dirac Hamiltonian people use in graphene, and this is the semi-Dirac Hamiltonian. But semi-Dirac Hamiltonian, which is also almost people claiming that they are very close to achieving it. Okay. Now look at this for our quench purpose, whether it is Dirac or semi-Dirac. Okay. Still, I write the name. If you search in Google semi-Dirac, you will see many interesting papers of 2013 only. This is the graphene Dirac point. Now, what you see that it tells us many things. Acha. Now, let us try to see what are the z exponents here. How do you find out z exponent? Z exponent, you have to see it at the quantum critical point, right? It is a two-dimensional problem. So, you take this Hamiltonian first. You set quantum critical point is where gap vanishes. When does the gap vanish? This is the term that is being driven. If you write out the energy expression, this will be some k square term and then mu square term. So, gap vanishes when mu is 0, kx and ky both equal to 0. Is that agreed? So, now look at this Hamiltonian. When mu is 0, I set kx, ky is equal to 0. So, minimum energy gap goes as kx, delta E goes as kx, right? So, that is my definition of z. If I do other way around, if I set kx is equal to 0, my minimum energy goes as ky. So, you have 2z. When this is 0, I am sitting at mu is equal to 0. This is equal to 0, energy scales with kx. This is equal to 0, energy scales with ky. So, it is a z is equal to 1 theory. Both cases z is equal to 1. Okay? So, this is this Hamiltonian. Now, I come to this Hamiltonian. Do you see any difference? Yes. If you set mu is equal to 0 and sit at kx is equal to 0, you have delta E going as qy. That means z is equal to 1. Okay? And if you, in the other term, mu is equal to 0, you set kx is equal to 0. Ky is equal to 0, your delta E goes as kx square, that gives you z is equal to 2. So, a single critical point, I have a single semi-Dirac point here, it has a linear spectrum in one direction and quadratic spectrum in other, okay? Quadratic in linear if you see as kx, and quadratic if you see as, sorry, linear if you say as ky, and quadratic if you say in the kx direction. If this is the case, this gives you a knowledge about anisotropic quantum critical point. There are anisotropic classical critical points also. So, this is an ideal example of anisotropic quantum critical point. Why anisotropic? Yes. Yes. So d and d plus 1, which we talk about, it's a very special situation when z is equal to 1. If you remember, no hyperscaling relation. Do you know hyperscaling relation? So let's not go into that. Okay. that follows from hyperscaling relation, and these type of cases hyperscaling relation gets modified. I will talk to you about hyperscaling recursion during T. Okay, I will explain to you. So all I am saying that there are two Z in the problem. One, let's say Z parallel, and other Z perpendicular. Okay, so it is a quantum critical point with two dynamical exponents, and Kewal-Zurek, where I was assuming single dynamical exponent, is no longer holds good in its pristine form. It has to be modified. How it is modified will be given in my slides. But what I want you to do, that you should check here, case 1, semi Dirac, defect density scale as 1 by tau. Case 1, defect density scales as this is 1, and case 2, defect density scales as 1 by tau. This is expected. This 1 by tau thing is expected. Let us check. Nu d, nu z plus 1. What is nu? Z is equal to 1. Sorry, this first case. Z is equal to 1. You can easily see nu is equal to also 1, because if you put Qx, Kx, Ky equal to 0, your gap will go as mu. That is the definition of Z nu. Can everyone follow me? Yes? Atanu? Clear? So, nu Z, if you put K is equal to 0, which I mean Kx, Ky both equal to 0, your gap scales as lambda mu, and this mu is nothing, Z nu is equal to 1. So, this problem, say case 2, nu is equal to 1, d is equal to 1, nu is equal to 1, z is equal to 1, and you will find out d is equal to 2, I am sorry. So, you put nu is equal to 1, d is equal to 2, this is 1 into 1 plus 1, so 1 by tau. Fantastic. This is Kewal-Zurek. But you will find out this is tau to the power 3/4. Okay? So, do this, find out it 3/4, and now reconcile with the note I have given, that what would happen a typical anisotropic quantum critical point. This is problem number 2. Yes, you seem to have a question. Right. Yes. Yes. Because what you have here is nu z. So, you will have this goes as nu, true also for semi Dirac. That means, if you take z perpendicular, nu perpendicular is equal to 1, z perpendicular parallel, nu parallel is equal to 1. You can define this. Okay? So, now how do you do this problem? This is very simple. This is a Landau-Jenner problem. Calculate the probability of excitation, integrate over kx and ky, you should get this result. This is also done in my slide, but I will be very happy if you do it on your own end. Find out in one case, it is Kewal-Zurek in its pristine form. One case calls for some changes in the Kewal-Zurek, because that is an anisotropic critical point. Okay? Okay. Now, coming back to what I was saying last thing. This is graphene, this is semi-Dirac. Semi-Dirac, because one direction it is Dirac, other direction it is Schrodinger or Newtonian. You have to change the, you know, in graphene you have two Dirac points. Okay? You have to push these Dirac points closer. When they merge, then you generate a semi Dirac spectrum. This is called topological merging transition. But people have not really achieved it. People are trying to apply light in graphene, which is called Floquet graphene. Okay? And trying to reach this topological merging point. Sorry. Avishkar, can you tell me the name of the experimental paper of semi Dirac points? I will tell you one of our later. This paper is in my bag, I can show. So, now coming back to where I stopped last, we talked about that I have a transverse Ising chain and I am coupling a central spin to it and looking at the decoherence. Now there are many questions which are legitimate questions that you are doing a unitary dynamics. How can you have a decoherence? Nothing should decohere. It's a unitary dynamics, and unitary dynamics preserves purity. If you start from a pure state, you should go to a pure state. This is true. What will happen? I'm looking globally at the qubit. Qubit loses its information, phase information, close to the quantum critical point. That is what I'm talking about, the decoherence of a qubit. Why does it happen close to quantum critical point? Because there is a small gap, vanishingly small gap, and there is a large length scale. So it becomes self-similar. Qubit as if becomes a part of the quantum critical system and sharing, exchanging information with the system. Otherwise, away from the critical point, the length scale of the many body system is very small. It does not sense that there is a qubit coupled to it and there is no exchange. This is the precise reason. Now, second question I explained to at least 20 students, that why you have two channels. This is very simple. My initial ground state, which is psi in minus infinity, and then one direct product with whatever Hamilton wave function of the spin chain, and then C2, I should put it this, direct product with phi g minus. So, this was this. How does this thing have evolved? Look at the Hamiltonian, if it is given there. Yes, this Hamiltonian. So, this total composite Hamiltonian is that of H plus the coupling. So, you have both. You have the both the guys. You are this Hamiltonian, I am writing the Hamiltonian composite Hamiltonian. Okay? H, this operates on this thing. Okay. Now, when this guy operates on this, it cannot flip to down, because I have not allowed any term that could cause an internal dynamics between this central spin. Okay. So, what it will do? I will diagonalize this Hamiltonian. It does not commute with anyone, this sigma z. It will just give me a plus sign to my transverse field. So, what will happen? It will happen. I have this Hamiltonian. Now, it is not the composite Hamiltonian, simply the transversizing Hamiltonian, the H written with H replaced by H plus delta phi g, and here this guy minus H replaced by H minus t. So, this is the two channels. I started with one phi g. But as time progresses, one follows this, other follows this. Is this point clear now? Only catch here in the composite Hamiltonian, there is a term sigma z, this particular term who commutes with every other member, and it simply gives me plus or minus 1 depending upon its state. So, it can be diagonalized in the basis of this many body Hamiltonian. So, this is one. Now, let me proceed. So, I said that qubit, decoherence of the qubit will be given by at any instant time t, it will be given by this overlap. Now, proceed. Okay. I want to show these two pictures which I included. If you look at a particular time, that is, these are nothing new, that three dimensional picture I have taken it. Okay. Now, you can see that if you choose a particular t, I am not driving. Okay. Nothing is being driven. I am choosing different lambdas or different gammas for this matter. Here gamma, for this particular work, gamma is the driving transition. Gamma drives the transition. Now, if you see that gamma is equal to 0, that is the critical point, you have fixed a time. So, you are changing your parameter gamma for different values and let it evolve in an equilibrium Schrodinger dynamics, and you will find out it shows a dip right at the quantum critical point. okay, at a particular time. What would happen if you look at the time evolution at a function of time sitting at the quantum critical point? You will find Ravi oscillations. But this is a characteristic of the two level problem I am considering here. It will just have two frequencies, h plus delta corresponds to 1, h minus delta corresponds to 1, and these two frequencies at the critical point there will be an oscillation. Okay? So, these are two things, and one more thing for which unfortunately I could not find a, I can erase this, this is clear. Okay. What you will see that you fix your parameter lambda or gamma, whatever, gamma in the figure, lambda or gamma, you close it very close to the critical point, very close to lambda c, and start at t is equal to 0, you will find out that there is a decay with some constant alpha t square. This is called early time decay. Okay? You start at t is equal to 0 and your parameter is very close to lambda, you will find an exponential decay. This is what Paolo Gianardi and others first proposed. Paolo Gianardi and Guan, I believe, they proposed that there will be an early time decay and that will be a characteristic of quantum critical point. This is all about equilibrium thing. Now, I want to go to what we will have, what we will have. See, remember, what is my system? My system is a Ising model or XY model in a transverse field. It is coupled to a qubit. All that qubit does, it gives it two channel of evolution, and then essentially I am looking for, after the quench, I will quench it. After the quench, I will look at how the decoherence evolves with time. Okay? So, now these are the things we have already seen. I have just simplified notation. I have said h j x plus j y, they were a parameter. If you remember the phase diagram, this is the phase diagram. Okay? J x plus j y I have settled equal to 1, and gamma is my measure of anisotropy, difference between j x and j y. And then this Hamiltonian, still for every k mod, you have 2 Hamiltonian, 2 by 2 Hamiltonian, which is given simply like this, and plus minus refers to the 2 channel. Now, AC should be slightly higher, right? I am also feeling the heat, sorry, slightly cooler. Okay. Okay. Sanjeev, thora sa. Okay. Now, this is the 2 by 2 Hamiltonian. Plus minus stands for two situations, that in one case you have h plus delta, one place h minus delta. Now, you know, I have shown you explicitly Jordan-Wagner transformation decouples is to the qubit form of the ground state. This is again this qubit form of ground state. This is the uk and vk. You start from 0 at minus infinity. You are expected to go to k minus k at plus infinity. Okay? But there is a quantum critical point, and there will be admixture of both the states at the final state, which will give you the defect. Is that clear? Now, you can calculate this overlap, and you can find out this decoherence factor is actually given by this. I remind you, what is the decoherence factor? You are looking at the qubit, and it is of diagonal term. Okay? Now, if you look at this decoherence factor, you want to calculate this log of f k. This can be easily found out, that I will show. But what is the main result? Main result is, if you calculate this decoherence factor, it will have a early time scaling like this, alpha t square. If your parameter is close to quantum critical parameter, you cross the quantum critical point at lambda is equal to 0, and then you will find out it scales as t square f tau. Okay? Okay? And now, this f tau may or may not have a scaling of that of defect density, which we have learnt in detail is given by 1 by square root of tau. So, how to calculate dt? Okay? Use the integrable two-level nature of Hamiltonian. So far away from the quantum critical point, so we have crossed the quantum critical point and I have a two levels. Now they will be just evolving with their Schrödinger equation. They are not talking to anybody. So situation is like this. I started from h is equal to minus infinity. This is my one quantum critical point at h is equal to minus 1. This is my other quantum critical point at h is equal to plus 1. I simply quench it some positive value, very high. So I have generated whatever defects I would, because you know everything happens in the vicinity of these two quantum critical points. So here you want to look at what is the scaling of defect density. You know that is 1 by root tau. Now let me set my clock here. This is my t is equal to 0. Okay? And I want to see how, what happens to this admixture state that I have created. Why the admixture? Because I have crossed the quantum critical point. I cannot go to kk minus minus k. I will have a mixture of both uk and vk. How do they evolve? They simply evolve uk, if you, there is you e to the power I e t, okay, if the characteristic energy is E. This technique actually is fantastic, which I learned from this paper by Shubhrato and Polman and others. Okay. So what happens? Two levels you have, they will independently evolve. How do they evolve? Now quenching, everything is done. I am here. This is my t is equal to 0. I have come here and this is my t is equal to 0. Okay. How do they evolve? First guy does not have any energy, so I can set that equal to 1. What about the second guy? Second part, it has two excitations. Okay? So it will evolve with a delta plus. This delta plus I have written. I know this expression, we have derived this expression using Jordan-Wigner transformation. All that I am writing in a different form, because I have said jx plus jy is equal to 1 and jx minus jy is equal to gamma. Right? So this all we have seen. Now it's essentially two level problem, one evolving with no energy, other with this excitation. There is no interaction. All that you have to calculate the overlap of these two. Okay, that gives you a decoherence factor. Remember, this is my time t is equal to 0. I have done the quenching. After the quenching, defects are generated. I am set my clock. This is my t is equal to 0. I am looking at the evolution of two free levels. Okay, now I want to calculate this, but who will give me uk and vk? See, I started with z 0. I should go to k minus, but I will go to uk 0 plus vk k minus k. I am asking the question, what is mod uk square? What is the probability that it is excited? It is still given by my Landau-Jenner formula, right? So this thing I have also derived. Okay, whatever we have used in yesterday and the day before, all are being used here. So uk square, I know this is the expression. If you had taken note that time, this is the expression we say it for Landau-Jenner problem. Once you have done this, you can easily calculate fkt. Remember, your decoherence factor was integral, exponential integral of these f factors. Those who have forgotten, I just remind you. This is the quantity I want to find out, log fk. Okay? And this is my fk. But there is a sinusoidal oscillation in this. So here comes, someone asked me in lunch table that how important role, what is the important role that your delta plays? The question, answer is here. If delta is small, okay, with respect to the time scale you are working on, then you will have an oscillation. Okay? This reminds you the oscillation I showed in the equilibrium case. This is not interesting to me. What is interesting to me, if I make delta very, very small, this is large delta, it oscillates. Large delta, it oscillates. Small delta, it is an exponential decay. What I will do? I will delta is small, t is such that delta t much less than 1, I will expand sin square delta as delta square. Okay? This I told you in the beginning, there is a note of warning. I have to work within a given range of time with small delta. Okay, this is the reason. Once I do this, I have an exponential decay and I can calculate the decoherence factor. This is the exact expression for the decoherence factor. I have shown you the somehow heuristic thing, UK, VK, and using the Landau-Jenner, assuming completely decoupled two levels. But one could solve exactly the Weber function approach, that also we have done, and one could find out the decoherence factor. Remember, this decoherence factor comes in the off-diagonal term of 2 by 2 density matrix, telling you this is the loss of information of the qubit. Okay? I used intentionally put this before, because this uses whatever information we gathered in last two classes. So, this is here, and you immediately find out why I am so excited, or people who proposed it were so excited. This is 1 by square root of tau. You can see a 1 by square root of tau sitting in the exponential clearly. That says probably this has the same defect scaling as the defect density. Okay? But later, I will not go into that. If you cross a multicritical point, you will find similar scaling as the defect. Okay? If you go many other ways, but not always. We have shown, yes, this is the original paper of Zurek, which I was not finding. They proposed this 1 by square root of tau and claimed that probably it is square like the defect density always. I always sensed that that is a coincidence, that the same defect density. So, we have some examples which I will not elaborate on, okay, that this is not always the case. So, this is what all I wanted to say about decoherence, and if you have any question at this point, please ask me before I switch to different slide. I have not shown, but when you see the slides, there is an example within the 2 by 2 models where decoherence factor is not, does not scale as defect density. I would like to make a comment here that you quench through the quantum critical point, that gives you a defect. Otherwise, you would have expected your final state is all up. Okay? That your final state is not all up, every spin locally has a probability of being down also. That actually renders, otherwise, which would be otherwise a direct product state. This quenching actually gives a possibility of local mixing. If you look at one particular guy, it has some probability of being up and being down. And that is why when you quench final state, there is a quantum correlation. You will find a quantum discord non-zero, a quantum concurrence which is non-zero. And in these integrable models, they all scale as light defect. But this is an example that decoherence factor even within this model, which you will see that in this example, I just mentioned that where it does not work. It does not work when you quench the system around this red line. This red line, if you quench along this red line, this, I'll take all questions. The defect density and the decoherence factor have different scaling. Yes. No, no, no. If coupling is very large, then delta takes over. Delta takes, actually, if coupling is very large, it will be decaying, and that decay will be, some sense, could be insensitive to quantum critical point. So, from my point of view, delta large is not very interesting. Okay? So, for quantum critical point community, the delta small is the right region. Yes. Also discord. Both we have checked. One is by Krishnendu and Diptiman, and one is Ayuti Patra, Tanay Nag and me. I am not saying that. Probably we can discuss over T. All I am saying that you are evolving from a pure to pure state because it is an unitary dynamics. When I look at locally, spins are uncertain. It could be could be up, could be down with some probability. That is reflected in this quantum correlation. That's all I say. Whole guy is a pure state. Whole guy is a pure state. But if you look at locally integrating over the other things, so I can talk more about this, the defect. It could be entangled. If you look at, that's what I am saying, whole thing is a pure, because you have taken a state, evolved it with unitary operation, it has to be pure. When I look at locally, okay, I'll give you an example. That is not concurrence or something. I wanted to do it towards the end, but I will do it now, since you asked this question. But I'll give you a very heuristic argument here. Look at this picture. Look at this picture, please. Look at this picture. Okay, this is something. This is actually first done by Chang and Levitov. I should have written it somewhere. Yes. So you quench from minus T to plus T, and you ask what is the density matrix. See, here density matrix will be always decoupled in the Fourier space, because you are starting with T by 2 problems in the Fourier space. Okay. So you have a rho k. Rho k will be given by p k and 1 minus p k and some off diagonal terms. These off diagonal terms ensures that it is locally, if you look at it, it is pure. Okay. Now, what happens if you get t very goes to infinity, done in details in Tsarnaev and Levitov. If you do this, and these off diagonal terms actually happen to be rapidly oscillating terms. So, when you integrate over momenta, for large oscillating terms which are function of k, they will all vanish. So, what you have is a decohered density matrix. This is a mixed state. When you integrate, you think of integrating over momenta. Levitov called it, this is a coarse graining in momenta. Okay? If you do it, you have a decohered matrix. All that I can tell it very hand waving way. We were all up, we went through a quantum critical point. We reached a pure state, but all of us have some probability of being down, being reverse. All of us have a finite probability of being reversed or wrongly oriented with respect to what is expected. And that gives a local mixing. Very crudely, I am saying this. But one can calculate using this decohered density matrix, you can calculate what is the entropy, and you see very nice result. This entropy actually shows a peak. Entropy shows a peak for some value of tau. Very small tau, nothing happens even locally. Why, can you guess? What happens very small tau? No? Small tau means you are going very fast. If you go very fast, what would happen? You nearly remain what you are. You are all up, you will be nearly what you are. So, locally also there is not much change. If you go very large tau, what do you expect? You are going very slow, defect production will be minimum, right? Is this clear? Both the ends, these ends, defect production is maximum. That means you are what you were. Here, tau going to infinity, you are what you are nearly expected to be. Okay? And there is some maxima, okay, somewhere here for some rate of tau where entropy maximizes. This is the pristine way of seeing that driving through a quantum critical point actually gives you some local von Neumann entropy. That is how I will call it. Yes. Sorry? Right, true. But it is not the same thing. It is not the same thing. I am just looking at particular momentum, p k, and I am that calculating a von Neumann entropy and integrating over k. But after quenching, you can also look at the size of your system. that also people have studied, and that shows also signature that there is a some scaling given by tau. Okay, Cincinio and others, they quenched it to T is equal to 0 and looked at the block entropy, taking a block, and that shows a signature that it scaled with a tau. Okay, and then you also know the Anatoly has some other thing where he starts with this pk and minus pk. Directly he is saying this diagonal entropy, because von Neumann entropy is always conserved. So there is a concept also which I did not discuss, that is called diagonal entropy, which Anatoly introduced. This has a similar behavior like this. So now finally, I have talked about nonlinear quenching. Last half an hour, I will just mention one interesting result which we obtained, and I promised you yesterday that what happens in a multicritical point. So these are two Ising critical lines. This is an isotropic critical line, and now you can cross a multicritical point. And how do you cross this multicritical point? Let's say I have a two-parameter scaling. Now have two parameters. This is the multicritical point. I am focusing on that multicritical point right there, denoted by A. And now I am asking the question that if I somehow cross this multicritical point, what would happen? Two things happen. Before I proceed further, I can tell you there are two things happen. One thing, Kibble-Zurek exponents depend on the way you approach the multicritical point, and these are not conventional Kibble-Zurek points. So this is your multicritical point, and you see this is the multicritical point A. I can set my notation. I can say h minus 1 is equal to lambda, and gamma, which is the anisotropy, I remind you, j x minus j y. These are the two parameters. I am quenching two parameters. Maybe I can do it both t by t tau first. So now consider, forget about this is a phase diagram. This is a parameter space. One axis is lambda, h minus 1, and other axis is gamma. And the multicritical point is sitting at h is equal to gamma is equal to 0. So this is your multicritical point. So if you go along this, you can easily see that you are crossing the multicritical point in a linear path. That is your, if that is your lambda axis, because I shift h to h minus 1, that is your lambda axis, and this is your gamma axis. So you are changing this linearly, okay, and cross the multicritical point along this red line, which is linear. Just give me a minute, I have to find out this pointer. Yes, point should be lambda is equal to gamma is equal to 0. Yes, thank you very much. So this is the multicritical point which I am probing, and you can easily see if h is always equal to gamma, you are actually crossing this line like this. Okay. Now what would happen? Now why it is different? Now if you write down the Landau-Jenner-Hamiltonian. Okay. So Landau-Jenner-Hamiltonian is now lambda k square. All I have done, the 2 by 2 Hamiltonian I have been showing, that is expanded near the multicritical point. So cos k, I have expanded cos k, retained the first order. It was h plus cos k. Cos k you expand about pi, first term gives you, okay, very, I should be precise. H plus cos k was my diagonal term. J x j y is set equal to 1. So you will have expanding around pi, pi minus k square. This is my lambda, and this is rescaled k. Okay? So this is what I am getting. This term is this, and gives me lambda plus k square. K is rescaled. So this is the Hamiltonian, sigma z, gamma z, lambda k, sin k expanded around pi, sigma x. This is my Landau-Jenner problem. I am talking about 2 by 2 problem once again. And now you see, I am doing two parameters, right? This guy is scaling. This guy is changing. This guy also has a k sigma x. Okay? If you look at this, this is a very funny situation. You will find out that your minimum gap, where is your multicritical point? Multicritical point at t is equal to 0, right? Multicritical point is lambda is equal to gamma is equal to 0, which is t is equal to 0. Okay? Now I am asking the question, where is the gap minimum? Earlier we never bothered about it. Earlier my gamma was not having any scaling. Gamma didn't have any t dependence. Okay? So once gamma has t dependence, if you write the Landau-Jenner problem, you have to be very careful. You have to remember that Landau-Jenner problem now looks like t by tau k square, and then a t by tau k minus of t by tau plus k square. So you see the difference? Where is the problem? Where is the problem? If I want to do, this is my Landau-Jenner problem. Where is the problem? This. I always said it is delta square, and delta was a constant. That is the minimum gap. Once you have your tau sitting here, you will be in trouble. So, this is a very simple case. What you can do? You can do a unitary transformation and bring that entire t dependence to of diagonal term. That can be done. But the next example I am going to give would be different. Now see, minimum gap occurs not at t is equal to 0, but when t by tau is actually of the order of k square. This is the point. Okay? I could have done this problem in two ways. First, do a unitary transformation and see what is the Landau-Jenner probability. Okay? Now, I just want to tell you, because I want to go to more complicated situation where I cannot do Landau-Jenner exactly. So, t by tau k square, this is where your minimum gap occurs. Large tau limit, minimum gap is going to contribute to your defect production. Momentum scales with tau with a negative power, if I remember, right? It was k tau to the power minus z or something, I do not remember. If this is the case, now this term was giving you the gap. Everybody agrees? The minimum gap at t is equal to 0 was 2 delta. Who was giving that? This is given by this guy. Okay? Now, if I substitute this, say here, t by tau is k square, that is the point what is the minimum gap. What is my minimum gap? Minimum gap, how does it go with k? This is k square. There is a k already here. So, how does the minimum gap go? K cube. So, it is k cube. Achha, minimum gap goes as k cube. So, what is your Landau-Jenner probability then? Exponential k to the power delta square, right? No, 3, no 3. 6 tau integrate over dk. What is your probability? 1 by tau to the power 1/6. And this was a very surprising result. This was a surprising result in the sense, I told you, it is not 1/4 as predicted by Kevel-Zurek. Why it is not 1/4? Because what original idea stays, tau going to infinity limit, minimum gap should come to the through like this, and this is my result. So, this you can do. Also, I told you, you can check, do a unitary transformation, get rid of time entirely from here, you will exactly find k to the power, tau to the power 1/6. These were very surprising, and we were very happy when we derived it in this case, first with a paper with Uma, Victor and Diptiman. Now, later I took it further. I said, okay, I play a little bit with this. So, what I do, I make a change my lambda goes as gamma to the power r and gamma goes as t by tau. Oh, my r and gamma are close. Okay, I'll write it alpha. Huh? So, r written here is alpha in this. Gamma and r, in my case, is very close. Gamma goes as this. So, gamma goes linearly with time. Okay? And lambda goes as t by tau to the power alpha with appropriate sign of gamma, sign gamma if you like, sign t. Okay? Now, you see this is a funny picture. Two parameters are being changed. This guy goes linearly, this guy goes non-linearly. How does it reflect in the parameter space? If you look at the parameter space carefully, you will find very interesting thing. Not working. Anyway. No. Oh, yes. So, this is your first case I discussed. Because it is gamma is always like this. Other case is gamma is alpha, lambda is r to the power some alpha, which means you are choosing a path. So, you are approaching multicritical point. This alpha, if you like, is the path parameter. It tells you, you approach the point in a different path. If you go straight line this way, this is a linear path for which defect density is tau to the power 1/6. Now, what would happen if you now, so this picture is clear, one parameter gamma being changed linearly, other parameter lambda, which is changed with a power law fashion, t by tau to the power alpha, okay, alpha r there is alpha here, sorry, but so one guy changes linearly, one guy changes in a power law fashion, which means in this parameter space picture, I am having curved paths, I am approaching multicritical point along different paths, okay. Now, I think I will erase this. So, lambda is equal to gamma to the power alpha, gamma changing as t by tau. This is the information I need. I keep it here. Once again, I will write my 2 by 2 Hamiltonian. So, that will be now Hk lambda. Remind you once again what I am doing. Lambda k square sigma z k gamma sigma x. This is diagonal. This okay. So, you can see now what I am doing. This is my quenching scheme. It is a two parameter quenching t by tau plus k square sigma z plus k t by tau sigma x. So, here is a time dependence, theek hai? Here is a time dependence, here is a time dependence. Okay? So, this is the two things I am doing. Okay? Now, where does the minimum gap occur? Minimum gap occurs when this guy is 0, right? Yes, minimum gap occurs when this guy is 0. Okay? Now, if this is my minimum gap, what I can do? I can make an expansion around the minimum gap point. And if I make an expansion, this Hamiltonian will look like tau effective sigma z is equal to tau, what is t naught? T naught, I'll write down. K t by tau to the power sigma x. So, I have expanded around the minimum gap. So, what defines my t naught? T naught is defined by this condition t naught tau to the power alpha plus k square is equal to 0. Okay? So, this be the case, this is my situation. You see that situation, this is a mistake, 2 phi alpha plus 1. So, once I linearize it around the minimum gap point, I get this thing. Okay? I have made a mistake, I am sorry. This will be, this previous step was correct. So, first thing you do, you find out that t naught, expand this term around the t naught and replace for t is equal to t naught here, because minimum gap is the business. So, it is 2 to the power 2 gamma sigma x. Okay? Now, there is an effective tau, effective, which scales as tau to the power k minus 2 alpha minus 1 by alpha. Okay? No, I made a mistake. Tau effective is equal to tau k to the power. Yes, that's fine. So, this is what I have gotten. Okay? Now, its scale is set for me to use the Landau-Jenner problem. I can find out the Landau-Jenner problem from this. It is a Landau-Jenner problem. Only thing minimum occurs as tau t 0, okay? And tau effective depends on k. Tau, if you put alpha is equal to 1, you will find out your tau effective is it's 0. So, tau effective is equal to tau. Yes, t naught will depend on k, because your minimum gap depends on, if you look at the linear term, forget about this, because it is not reaching. What do you read as t is equal to 0? Multicritical point. But gap is lowest not at the multicritical point, slightly shifted from it on the ferromagnetic side. Okay? So, once you have this, now you see this is a Landau-Jenner problem once again. It is a 2 by 2 problem. This guy has an effective tau, this is the minimum gap. So, you can immediately calculate what is your dk. Dk is exponential pi minimum gap, that is k 4 plus 2 into tau effective. You calculate this quantity and you will find out it is tau to the power, I have written tau to the power alpha over 6. Okay? So, defect density will depend on alpha. That means, defect density will depend upon the path you are taking to reach the multicritical point. So, this is a special situation. Even within this 2 by 2 integrable problems, in which it is not the straightforward Kivel-Zurek, if you take the multicritical point, close to the multicritical point, there are minimum gap regions. You cross the multicritical point, it depends upon how you approach the multicritical point. You can see alpha is equal to 1, you get back the result 1 by 6. And over the region alpha is equal to 1 to 2, this exponent continuously varies. So, what I have found out, I may have written it here. Yes. In fact, there are some, these points I am calling quasi-critical points, let us not go on to, let not go into that, that there are exponents which usually depend on path. Okay? Exponents depend on path when you approach multicritical point. It can continuously change, it can continuously change from 1/6 to 1/3. And I told you that that particular line, if you quench, I did not show, but it is a very simple homework exercise you can take. Along this simple line, it is 1/3. So, 1 to 2, it is continuously varying. Above that, it is as if it is coming like these critical lines. Okay? This critical line is tau to the power 1/3. No. Alpha 3, then it saturates, this whole mechanism fails. If you alpha is greater than equal to 2, this whole thing breaks, okay, because then your gap will be at the multicritical point, which is like you come along this. So alpha is equal to 1 to alpha is equal to 2, these are two boundaries. This is alpha is equal to 1, this is the region where whatever I am saying does not hold good. I am linearizing. If it is sublinear, there is no point in linearizing it. This is the region alpha is equal to 1 to alpha is equal to 2, where exponents actually are varying continuously. And then it is as if you are coming along this line. Okay? So this is a simplest example of where that Hebel-Zurek needs to be carefully looked at. Quenching, sudden quenching, I gave you an example of slow and sudden. What is slow? Slow means you are going slow in compared to the characteristic time scale of the problem. Sudden means you are doing very fast. Okay? That means particle in a box, you change suddenly, abruptly the one of the walls. The wave function does not evolve. No, particle in a box, I am not talking about quenching, I am just suddenly changing the wall. Okay? This wave function, this example I gave in the very first class. So, in this case, what is important parameter is lambda, okay? The amount you have quenched. So, then who will set you the k? I told you. In the sudden slow quench, if you remember what we said? We said that tau sets a scale for momentum, okay, and defect density is the corresponding scale of momentum raised to the power d for a d-dimensional system. Yes, momentum was scaling as k was scaling as tau to the power nu d nu z plus 1, and defect density was the phase space spanned by this momentum nu d. Whatever phase space occupies, this momentum occupies this amount of phase space, and that is your Hebel-Zurek scaling route. Now you have to see the scaling dimension. Lambda f is k. You know that the scale, that length scale goes as lambda to the power minus nu. I am starting from a critical point, okay, and changing, make a small change from that by lambda and suddenly. Okay? So, if I do that, lambda is my characteristic thing, and that sets what is my k. So, my k hat would be lambda f to the power nu. This is dimensionally exact. If you remember, length scale as lambda to the power minus nu. So, momentum should scale as lambda to the power nu. So, this is your k, and what is your defect density now? That what is the amount of phase space that with this k? That is lambda to the power, lambda f to the power nu d. This is the sudden quench Hebel-Zurek theory, if you like, and this was given by this paper, Grandi, Gritsev and Polkovnikov, and it can be related to something which is very interesting, quantum information people may like, which is called fidelity susceptibility. But I am not going into that. My plan was there, and it is in details in my slides. So, since I am already exceeding time almost, just remember there is a so called Hebel-Zurek for sudden quench. If you start from a critical point and make a jump of amount lambda f, your momentum scale will be given by lambda f to the power nu, and how much phase space that is covers, that is lambda f to the power nu d, that is the defect. Yes. Yes. True. Actually, idea is what ideally you can think of, there is a region which I so called as free, okay, where relaxation is very large. So, if you go stop your quench, stop critical point here, you will call it a sudden quench, because for the low energy modes in this region they do not evolve. But if you cross this region and very much again in the adiabatic region, you will use the slow quench result. Okay. this is slow, and if you stop here, it is sudden. But these two limits we know for sure. Okay. Now, fidelity susceptibility, this is there in my note. Now, it is time, last 10 minutes, I will summarize, and then I believe Alessandro will take over soon, tomorrow or today. So, this is the summary. So, you can see how much material you will be having, just to gloss through. Okay. Yes, this is the summary. We have seen quenching across a quantum critical point generates defects. I told you, there is nothing sacrosanct of quantum critical point. Crossing a quantum critical point will generate defects. It is because diverging relaxation time. What is beautiful in quantum systems? You have a spectrum, there is a vanishing gap at the quantum critical point, and the diverging time scale is a consequence of this vanishing gap. There is an exponent z there outset in the problem. This slow quenching, this is your Hubble's direct result. What I have done has been shown this exactly for transverse XOI and Eisenspins. They are two level, do Jordan-Wigner transformations, they get reduced to two level problems, and then you can do Landau-Jenner to calculate the probabilities. And from that probability, you integrate over mods, calculate the phase space area covered by defects, you exactly get the result that is given there. Now, I have told you the story does not end here. It is not that Landau-Jenner, Kivel-Zurek should be valid only for this two level reducible system. I give you an example of non-integrable model, where you have the transverse Ising model, apply just a longitudinal field. All the beauty of Jordan-Wigner transformation is destroyed. You cannot reduce it to two level problems, but people have done extensive numerics and they have found out Kivel-Zurek is satisfied, unless Kivel-Zurek is satisfied in the sense you remember that exponent nu depends upon how you move away from the quantum critical point. Some people were trying to get that 8/23. I hope who discussed with me, I do not remember, but 8/15 critical exponent everybody found, some of you found, right? This is just the calculation of scaling dimension which gives you this. Okay? Then more importantly, the heuristic argument I gave, it is very simple to explain, but there is adiabatic perturbation theory. Okay? In the first order approximation, which should be very correct when you go from the very negative value of lambda to very positive value of lambda, this establishes the Kivel-Zurek. It was done by Polkovnikov. Modifications, I talked about nonlinear quenching, where you will find that all that happens, nu gets renormalized by r nu, which once again is driving home the fact that nu exponent depends upon how you approach the critical point. And then I gave you a homework, which is actually a PRL paper by Barankov and Polkovnikov. These I showed the multicritical point, where it is a very simple situation, but multicritical point exponent is different from what is expected from the Kivel-Zurek. I taught about a two parameter scaling, okay? And then I showed that defect density can depend upon the path with which you are hitting the multicritical point. Okay? And here I will stop. Then there are many, many extensions. Okay? Anisotropic quantum critical point. This is one of your homeworks. Okay? That how to see that Kivel-Zurek gets modified. How correct it Kivel-Zurek form extended quantum critical region, for example, Kitaev model or XXZ Heisenberg chain. Okay? Then chain coupled to heat bath. These last two work, extended quantum critical region, spin chain coupled to a heat bath. These are Silvers, so you can catch him if you want to know more. And then systems with quench disorder. Onolabu was asking a question. 1D system, there is a logarithmic behavior with the rate, and quantum glasses, I do not know, people are trying, but whether there is for example, a random higher dimensional Ising model in a transverse field, what should be the Kivel-Zurek, I do not know whether people have reached any consensus on those. So, Kivel-Zurek defects are formed. At this point, I will stop with some more comments. One here, Vitak. What do you want? So, for the quantum information interested people interested in quantum information, quenching through quantum critical point generates quantum correlations in the finite state, which would otherwise be absent. Concurrence and defect satisfy same scaling as defect with a asking sign, because this has been shown only for two level systems. Not any generic argument will tell you that it is always scale as defect. So, it is a open thing. Scaling of decoherence factor, which I said, in many cases it seems it is like defect, but whether beyond two level system, we have shown even within this transversizing model, it may not satisfy the same scaling and the defect density. So, this is also an open area to probe what should be the scaling. And sudden quenching, this is related to fidelity susceptibility, which I cannot cover, but it is there. And this fidelity susceptibility, if you look at the multicritical point, you can also see very interesting behavior, which nowhere has been seen, that fidelity susceptibility actually shows an oscillation near multicritical point. This we saw with Victor and Anatoly. So, this is all I wanted to say. Now, nothing is complete without my collaborators. I learned many things from my students, many of them here, Tonai, Sitodhi, Atonu, I am sorry, I forgot your name somehow, but you are there. So, these are, and of course, Professor Deepthiman Sen, Anatoly Polkovnikov, R.R.P. Singh, and I talk to many, many friends, Krishnendu, Shubrato, who teach me a lot of things. And finally, also, I have written this review, B.K. Chakraborty, Rosenbaum and Apley, which will appear as a book, I told you. So, if you have some time and look at this, and if you think some extra material should be put it, and some changes should be made, some modifications, clarifications should be made, if you write to me, we are in the final stage, we are compiling it. So, if you please give me your feedback at this moment, we can incorporate it and I will feel very grateful. So, defects are formed. Now, people will look at how they coercion, how they thermalize, and my job stops here. Thank you very much. So, any question? Any question?
An equivalent statement saying that it actually generates entanglement.
Of course, locally. The whole system is pure. If you want to take look at one of them and integrate out others, okay, then
that's in a mixed state, because that's
in a mixed state. But if there were no defect, all were up, all these fields are direct product of each other.
Right.
That's the reason. But question what remains, that's why this time, that is the concurrence scale with as same way as the defect? I would still say yes for two level systems. Beyond that, I don't know.
I think he's asking which one is more fundamental.
In fact,
and right, is that what you're asking? What is entanglement? Is entanglement more fundamental than defect? Is that what you're asking?
No. So what I'm saying is that essentially they're equivalent here, because defects are because of the
quenching.
Because
which?
Of entanglement. That's
no. I don't think so. Defects are not because of entanglement.
Defects are because of quenching.
Yeah.
Because defects are because of quenching. Because you generate defects, you result in some correlations. That's
defects
the point.
Defects are because you're going
through a quantum critical point.
Going through a critical point.
Quantum critical point or critical point, so be precise. No, it is not the entangle of these spins. No, it doesn't.
Defect is more fundamental.
In the present, yes. Had there been no defect, no. That's why your entropy, that picture I showed, if you like.
By a defect, you just mean that a particular spin can be probabilistically up or down, right?
Yes, defects.
So that's because.
You have points to defect there. If you have points to the critical point,
yeah.
That's it. I show you this picture once again. That will clarify why she is saying that defects this picture.
Yeah, but Amit, I think you should clarify what is more fundamental, because
see, when tau goes to infinity, if you say this entropy is my, which is measuring of local mixing, this is measure of my quantum,
that's a
measure of entanglement. So, measure of entanglement in a very crude sense. Tau goes to infinity, it goes down. That means there is no defect, there is no correlation. Here, tau goes to zero, these are all defects, and that's why there it is like the same state what it was. And I started with a direct product state, it is nearly a direct product state.
Yeah, yeah, so there is no entanglement.
No.
But no, because defects come wherever you put supercritical point. Doesn't matter whether it's
No, that part he understands.
Entanglement is a consequence of the quantum part of it.
That because of the quenching that you have the eventual.
Yeah, but you keep saying entanglement.
No,
fundamental.
No, he's not saying that. Yeah. He
is. It's the equivalent.
No, I got you.
Depends on your language. Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question.
Please.
So, you talked about these point defects. And talked about the scaling, this point defect. But is there some sort of a scaling for us in terms of say domain walls or something? Like is that something which happens that when you quench, is there like domains formed also? And
I'll talk to you. Anyway, I have given my email address, so I'll be very happy to respond to any questions which may come to you. Yes.
Can I ask a question about the first sentence and the last sentence?
What is that?
So, you started with this using a Hamiltonian with next nearest neighbor interactions.
Hmm.
So now, when you go through the critical point, so you generate the defects, as you said, and they have this universal scaling and so on and so forth. On the other hand, since the model is not integrable, when you just move away from the critical point, you expect that the relevant time scale for your system to be adiabatic or whatever is not anymore the gap.
So, yes. This louder, I hear.
Well, my voice is limited. Okay. And I'm quenched.
Just
myself.
The relevant time scale is no longer separate.
is no longer the gap in the system because
right.
It's level spacing. So in practice, I mean, in order to see this, so do you think a measurement of kinks in a spin chain would reveal this this Kibble-Zurek scaling or not?
I don't know. That is the issue I first discussed in the beginning.
Oh,
that if
sorry.
You want to measure it, defects will. This is a simple model, but defects will talk to each other, right? Defects will start melting, and then they should coerce. And what will happen after that? How good is Kubel-Zurek after the quenching? That's.
But it's you did not study it.
No. That I left for you. I told in the beginning.
No, I thought you knew the answer.
Okay, let's thank Amit for his nice set of lectures.
Acha, thank you. So what is there? I don't know. I'm a quantum physicist. No, quantum physicist. I open it and I'll know.
Yeah.
Right?
Hopefully it will be helpful for you. I'll try more papers.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.